Hello, a warm welcome to Law and Order. I am Martia Umar. The program Law and Order focuses on enlightening the general public of the rights and responsibility of citizens of Nigeria and how to seek redress when these rights are violated. The program also features law enforcement agencies like the Nigerian Police, the Nigerian Army, Nigeria Customs, NAPTIP, NDLEA, the FIRC, VIO, Nigeria Correctional Service, and all the relevant security agencies in Nigeria to enlighten you on how to maintain law and order as it concerns the different security agencies, plus what the Human Rights Commission is doing to help Nigerians seek redress when these rights are violated. Now, Nigeria has been independent for more than 60 years, but under military rule for half that time. Perhaps the reason why many Nigerians have become accustomed to living in fear and oppression. However, when democracy was established in 1999, an event that was supposed to herald the beginning of a new era, most Nigerians expected that finally they are going to reap the benefits of a democratic order that puts them first through people-centered policies. But unfortunately, this dream turned out to have been largely been a mirage. But as many other countries and evolving democracies, Nigeria has to confront numerous challenges, and this include unemployment, underemployment, erratic power supply, infrastructural gaps, so insufficient social amenities, poor healthcare services, and the lack of access to quality education and human rights abuses, as well as a threat posed by violent extremism all in the past decade. Now, let's take a look at human rights in Nigeria and the journey so far.
The Declaration of Human Rights adopted by the United Nations General Assembly on December 10, 1948 came about after the Second World War. It is considered a milestone document in the history of human rights, detailing 30 of such inalienable freedom. The United Nations General Assembly proclaims this Universal Declaration of Human Rights as a common standard of achievement for all people and all nations, to the end that every individual and every organ of the society, keeping this declaration constantly in mind, shall strive by teaching and education to promote respect for these rights and freedom. Article 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights states that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. Article 2. Everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration, without distinction of any kind, such as race, color, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. Furthermore, no distinction shall be made on the basis of political, jurisdictional, or international status of the country or territory to which a person belongs, whether it be independent, trust, non-self-governing, or under any other limitation of sovereignty. Article 3. Everyone has the right to life, liberty, and security of person. Article 4. No one shall be held in slavery or servitude. Slavery and the slave trade shall be prohibited in all their forms. Article 5. No one shall be subjected to torture or to cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment or punishment. Article 6. Everyone has the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law. Article 7. All are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. All are entitled to equal protection against any discrimination in violation of this declaration and against any incitement to such discrimination. Article 8. Everyone has the right to an effective remedy by the competent national tribunals for acts violating the fundamental rights granted him by the Constitution or by law. Article 9. No one shall be subjected to arbitrary arrest, detention, or exile. Article 10. Everyone is entitled in full equality to fair and public hearing as an independent and impartial tribunal in the determination of the rights and obligation of any criminal charge against him. than 70 years after the Declaration of Human Rights adopted by the United Nations General Assembly, not all nations have guaranteed the protection, enactment, and actualization of these rights. The Federal Republic of Nigeria is a member of the United Nations and the African Union. It has ratified many UN human rights conventions and has made binding international commitments to adhere to the standards laid down in this universal human rights document. Human rights in Nigeria are protected under the 1999 Constitution as amended, while Nigeria has made major improvements in human rights under this Constitution. The American Human Rights Report of 2012 notes several areas where more improvement is needed, which includes abuse by Boko Haram, killings by government forces, lack of social equality, and issues with freedom of speech. These challenges have compelled Nigerians, typically known to be hardworking and resilient, to endure these pains while looking towards the state to cater to their needs. The Human Rights Watch 2015 World Report states that intensified violence by Boko Haram and government corruption continue to undermine the status of human rights in Nigeria. One of the most fundamental responsibilities of the state towards its citizens remains the protection of lives and property. However, law enforcement agencies like the Nigerian Police Force, the Nigerian Army, Federal Road Safety Corps, and other law enforcement agencies, which is saddled with the responsibility of ensuring law and order, is now seen by many as being unable to deliver on its mandates. Nigeria has witnessed an increase in human rights violations, such as unlawful and arbitrary killings, forced disappearances, and torture by both government and non-state actors. Human rights abuses and violations in Nigeria in general cut across the entire spectrum of rights. The abuses come in different forms and could be direct or indirect. The perpetrators of rights violation are hardly or never held accountable or brought to justice due to the array of problems besetting the judicial institutions. Some of the rights Nigerians are entitled to include the right to life, the right to health, the right to freedom from discrimination, the right to freedom of association and peaceful assembly, the right to equal protection of the law, right to the dignity of human person, right to work, the right to means of livelihood or employment, and the right to development. Some persons share their thoughts on human rights in Nigeria.
The human rights in Nigeria, well, they are doing enough, but they're not doing enough. In the first place, I would rather say something today that to the entire Nigerians who may listen to this thing, that the human right we have in Nigeria, sometimes they do their work, sometimes they are biased. In the sense that there are certain things that we are seeing, people are doing that you know is against the law of the nation. Instead of the human right to rise against and challenge that person, no, what you are doing now is against the law of the land. That when the law is catching up with you, we will not be on your side because you go ahead and look for it.
The human right in Nigeria is very, very poor. It's like 20 out of 100%. So you know how poor it is. Somebody that score 20 out of 100%, you know that is very, very poor. It's very poor because one, if a uniformed person in Nigeria, you believe you are superior to your fellow citizen who is a civilian, which isn't supposed to be so. Because you suppose, as a citizen of Nigeria, we are all equal. No, but even though you put that uniform, the law of Nigeria should be respected. But most of them, they're the ones breaking the law because they have uniform. The ones they put on that uniform, they consider themselves above the law. So the human rights in Nigeria is very, very poor, and we must do something about it.
In Nigeria, you can buy judges, you can buy police, you can buy paramilitary, you can buy military. You can use them to oppress innocent citizens to death without being proved guilty by the Judicial Court of Nigeria. They buy register in Nigeria, they buy justice in Nigeria. Everybody knows what is going on in Nigeria. We just need automatic divine intervention in all the sector of our economy in Nigeria. Yes, I'm putting it to you now. So at the same time, again, I have to call on UN, EU, African Union, ECOWAS, and ILO. They should urgently urge PMB Osibajo, Governor Forum, Council of Ministers, ALGON, to urgently improve the welfare and well-being of Nigeria, give Nigeria dividends of their democracy, fundamental human rights, rule of law, inject action and active to their humanitarian service to people of Nigeria.
The issue of human rights, I don't know. I might suffer from fallacy of generalization anyway. I just feel that it's the nature of a black man to, when he's given authority to take care of people, he turn around and violate them in the process. With the people that are supposed to protect Nigerians, the security people suffer from possession syndrome. They feel that they are deities and gods. And they turn around and violate the people that are supposed to protect. Unfortunately, what put food on their table is taxes from these common masses. Sometime ago in 2015, in November 22nd, I wrote something on Facebook complaining about the governor of my state, what he should do, what the president should do, and my local government chairman, former local government chairman, at that particular time was the SA to the governor on cooperatives and agriculture. He came online, threatened me that Mr. President does not know me, my government does not know me, but he knows me and he'll deal with me. And then on 22nd of November, he carried out the act. As you can see, I am a toothless. So when he caught some guys, he beat me up blue black. I took the case to the police, and the police simply advised me that there was nothing they could do. I should just let it go. And that was how it ended. So I'm a victim myself. And then cases like that abound.
Security agents in Nigeria have been accused of unethical, corrupt, and criminal conduct. For instance, the Nigerian Police and its then Special Anti-Robbery Squad, SARS, formed in 1992 to combat armed robbery and other violent crimes, was allegedly notorious for brutality against citizens. It has repeatedly been accused of committing the crimes it was created to respond to, and its members have been implicated in widespread human rights abuses, including extrajudicial killing, torture, arbitrary arrest, unlawful detention, extortion, and sexual violence. As a way of putting a stop to the endless incidences of human rights violations in Nigeria, rights defenders and activists launched a massive campaign tagged #EndSARS. The campaign was aimed at drawing attention to the human rights violations committed by the Special Anti-Robbery Squad, SARS, a unit of the Nigerian Police Force. One of the worst crackdowns was at the Lekki Toll Gate in Lagos on October 20, when army officers arrived in about 5 trucks and surrounded a large group of protesters holding a peaceful sit-in. In October 2020, the government dissolved the SARS and then came up with SWAT, which means the Special Weapons and Tactics Team. People who survived the use of excessive force at Lekki and other locations had tales of woe about the aftermath.
The first protest I joined was on Friday with other young guys like us. So we organized ourselves, okay, let us go on a peaceful protest and call these people out. They've been harassing, maiming, extorting, killing, robbing, raping people. It's everywhere. I'm a victim. My first SARS experience, I'm not lying. If I lie, let me sleep this night and not wake up. My first SARS experience, I was 14 years old. First start town, I was going to see my friend. I was stopped by the road. Hey, started searching my pocket. Okay, wait till they find, now wait till they find, blah, 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 blah. I was 14. So you see, these guys are actually trying to make it seem like, oh, we don't know what we are saying. The president said a few bad eggs, a few bad eggs have infiltrated the system since 2017. So it's taking him like 3-4 years to sort out the few bad eggs. SARS has been ended banned in 2017, 2018, 2019. This is 2020, and we come outside to ensure that, oh, we need this thing. We need to see, it's not about you coming out on TV or radio, passing information, sending circulars through other organizations to tell us that you have actually banned SARS, but this is still operating. You go see SARS, guy go tell you, so guy need to see what you want to do. Go and call the IG. The IG cannot do anything. It makes zero sense.
Why are they shooting tear gas at us? Why are they spraying us water, pressured water, harassing us, chasing us all over the capital? It doesn't make sense. Peaceful protest. We're not harming anyone. We're not doing anything. We're just fighting for our rights. We are speaking against the oppression. I have personal experience with them. They've harassed me when I was a student in Ife. They've harassed me before. They stopped me just because I looked good. I was going to buy beans that day and they stopped me because I looked good. Started harassing us because I had a good phone. Me and my friend, because we had a good phone. Why should I be harassed because I have a good phone? Why should I be harassed because I look good? It's a society and we're tired.
We were met with policemen running at us with sticks, shooting tear gas at us, pouring water on us. I mean, Nigerians are tired. This fight is no longer just for the youth. It's for Nigerians, it's for Africa. All Africans all over Africa, because we are tired. Police brutality is becoming a norm. It's becoming something acceptable. It's something we now laugh about. It's now a joke. We are tired. We can no longer continue. It's not just about SARS. It's about the police generally. Because many people think it's just about SARS, but it's not just about SARS. Even if you end SARS today, the unscrupulous elements that are in that unit, where do they go to? Where do you deploy them to? So we want a general reform. Laudable reforms, reforms that we can see, not the ones we hear on paper, not the ones we hear on social media. Reforms that we can see. We want these perpetrators being punished. The ones who misfire, who kill innocent citizens, they should be punished. Let us see them being brought to book.
One year after peaceful and SARS protests ended in a brutal crackdown by Nigerian security forces in Abuja, Lagos and other parts of the country, no one has been brought to justice for the torture, violence and killings of peaceful protesters, while reports of human rights violations by the police continue. An investigation by Amnesty International revealed that Nigerian army and police killed at least 12 people on 20th of October 2020 at Lekki Toll Gate and Alausa in Lagos.
Well, as far as we are concerned, nothing fundamentally has changed. All the reforms that we have agitated, or that Nigerian people have agitated, have not been carried out with all sorts of sincerity and seriousness and commitment as it should be. So that is why, as far as we are concerned, we have not seen those fundamental changes, especially in terms of police brutality, extortion, and corruption in the security sector. You could see that as a result of the security, corruption in the security sector, you could see how the whole country have been thrown into a serious threat of insecurity because of corruption in the security sector.
NSAS was a culmination of years and years of reports, complaints, agitations by the people. And what happened on 20th of October shook us in ways that it has not happened before, because these were defenseless people, young people who were facing nothing else but the toll gate. And yet their government security forces fired at them. I think that's what shook us beyond everything else we've experienced. And that is why the lessons that we are learning today is, how do we organize as a people? How do we do so safely and securely? And how do we get our country to listen, our government to listen to us without shooting at us? We can only move on from here by saying the truth. People have spoken, but we've chosen to listen to the government without listening to all actors in the process. I think it's not just one side of the story that should be told. Amnesty International verified information received from victims, from survivors, but also from family members and those human rights defenders that were on the ground. And this information has been documented in video, in postings, in messages, in petitions to various agencies, international organizations, even outside of this country. We shouldn't only be listening to one source, we should be listening to all sources. And there's a saying, there are three sides to a story. One is the side of the complainant, the side of the person being targeted, and finally the truth. We all should be seeking the truth. And I think when you're in a situation when one party has power and dominates, it's very easy to silence those who are not in the corridors of power.
A year on, despite the gravity of these human rights violations, not a single member of the security forces has been prosecuted, while judicial panels of inquiry set up to investigate abuses by officers have made little progress. Aside security agencies trampling on citizens' rights, citizens of the country are not left out as people's rights are violated by non-state actors as well. This and many more we seek to address on the program Law and Order, as ignorance is not an excuse in a court of law.
And this is how much we can take on this episode of the program Law and Order. Make sure you join us next week as we will be taking a critical look of human rights in Nigeria with a legal practitioner. Make sure to keep a date with us. Thank you so much for being a part of the program, and remember that ignorance of the law is not an excuse. Bye for now, and thank you for watching.